Good afternoon. We start with a fatal hit and run in Sydney's west that started with road rage. Police right now searching for the driver of a white ute who mowed down a 27-year-old man. It's believed the two were involved in an argument at Blackett just before 9 this morning. The victim then got out of his car on Josie Road and was subsequently hit.
Apparently the victim had gotten out of the vehicle after being threatened by the car following him, and obviously words were said. And that's what led us to believe it could have happened because of a road rage incident.
And if you know the driver of this white ute, detectives are now pleading to speak with him. Well, the federal opposition leader has spent the day on the defensive as the government tries to tear apart his nuclear power plan. We'll take you live to Canberra and our politics reporter Amanda Kopp. Amanda, good afternoon. Labor claims it lacks detail and it will cost taxpayers.
Davina, the federal government has come out pretty hard against the coalition's plan for nuclear energy. They say for such an ambitious plan, Australians need to know how much it would cost and whether building nuclear would actually bring down electricity prices, given the CSIRO says it's one of the most expensive forms of energy. It's also a shift away from traditional market rules policy from the coalition. Peter Dutton saying taxpayers would foot the bill, with the Commonwealth taking complete ownership of the 7 proposed nuclear plants. He says it would bring Australia into line with the rest of the world.
Of the top 20 economies in the world, Australia is the only one that doesn't have nuclear. Where nuclear is present, we know that electricity is much cheaper and it's reliable.
We'll have government ownership and send all the bills to the taxpayers, because there is no way that not a single private bank or financier in this country would go anywhere near this because it's such a risky economic proposition.
Now, the government is pushing ahead with its renewables plan, Energy Minister Chris Bowen announcing the next steps for offshore wind, confirming private investment in the Hunter region.
This is a concrete, practical, clear step forward. It contrasts with other events yesterday of a fantasy, many decades off, with no costings, no modelling, and no consultation.
Davina, we are less than 12 months out from an election and energy policy is shaping up to be one of the biggest debates.
But it certainly is. Okay, Amanda, thank you. Foreign Minister Penny Wong has spent the day visiting the victims of Papua New Guinea's devastating landslide. It comes after high-level meetings between a number of Australian cabinet ministers and the PNG ministry as Labor continues strengthening ties across the Pacific. Minister Wong announced support to help improve the justice systems and security, along with an additional $2 million for recovery and rebuilding efforts in the disaster-hit Enga province. Sydney's bird flu outbreak has now forced the closure of 3 other farms as authorities take precautionary steps to stop the spread. James Wilson reports.
The news keeps on getting worse here at this poultry farm in Freeman's Reach in the Hawkesbury region, with all 240,000 chickens now needing to be destroyed after bird flu was detected here yesterday. 8,000 chickens had already died from the virus before the Department of Primary Industries stepped in overnight. Veterinarian officers are now on site overseeing this operation. It's believed this outbreak, the first since 2013, may have been introduced by wild birds. The H7N8 strain here in Sydney's northwest is different to the strain detected in Victoria in late May, which has seen over 1 million birds killed across 7 farms. State government biosecurity protocols have been put in place here, including a 2-kilometre control radius around the farm. Workers have been seen disinfecting their boots on entry. Meanwhile, local traffic and trucks continue to drive by the property unaffected. So far, this outbreak has managed to be contained to this farm, while avian influenza, as it's also known, can be caught by humans. The health minister says there's no need to panic.
It doesn't transmit easily from animal to human. We've got to just stay calm about this. New South Wales Health and Primary Industries are working together on the situation.
And in another development, 3 surrounding farms in this area have been placed into lockdown this afternoon. On them are around 350,000 chickens. Nothing will be allowed to be taken in or out of those farms for the foreseeable future. Industry experts say this incident is unlikely to impact egg prices or supplies, but if this virus does spread, it could cause major concerns.
We'll take you to some developing news now, and drivers in our northwest are being told to expect significant delays after a truck crash on Windsor Road at Vineyard. One of the trucks caught a light following the collision, forcing authorities to close the road in both directions. And a large amount of diesel has also spilled onto the road. Crews still on the scene cleaning that up. Both drivers have been taken to hospital, one a 50-year-old man suffering head injuries. In Merrylands, a truck has slammed into two cars in a property. Police say the truck veered off Woodville Road before it ended up in the front yard of a home, damaging a fence. Thankfully, though, no one was injured. Well, a war is brewing between the state government and a council on our North Shore over the impact of proposed housing developments and threatened local species. Ku-ring-gai Council says the government's signature policy is unlawful because it will impact animals such as the powerful owl and the grey-headed flying fox. The matter is now before the court and is scheduled for a directions hearing on July 5. The latest report card on supermarket prices has unsurprisingly found Aldi is the cheapest place to do your weekly grocery shop. Consumer advocacy group Choice says the supermarket is 25% cheaper than Coles and Woolworths. Reports comparing prices at the major supermarkets will come out now every 3 months as the government tries to tackle a lack of competition in the industry.
More competition means a better deal for consumers, a fairer deal for farmers, and more dynamism in the economy for workers.
The next supermarket price report is due out in September. A farm in Sydney's northwest has become the site of the state's first case of bird flu in a decade. And for more on this afternoon, we're joined by Dr. Sandra Cuthbert from Food Standards Australia. Dr. Cuthbert, welcome. Can you tell us from your perspective and your agency what you know about this latest case?
Thank you. So avian influenza, there's a number of strains of avian influenza that occur, and they do occasionally occur naturally in the wild population of birds, and sometimes they can be transferred from the wild bird population into a commercial flock of birds. And unfortunately, it appears that that's what's happened here. So there's biosecurity control mechanisms which then take place as soon as that has happened, which is well underway. So I understand that this flock, it's not a spread that's happened from the other flocks that you'd be aware of in Victoria. It's a case that's likely transferred from wild birds into this flock, and now biosecurity measures will take stead. But from the Food Standards Agency, we're particularly concerned about food safety, and I do want to assure everyone that avian influenza bird flu is not considered to be a food safety issue for commercially prepared and packaged poultry, eggs and egg products.
That's the concern that a lot of people have, that whether you're purchasing eggs or chicken products or whether you're eating out, is there any sort of potential risk to humans here?
No, there's no evidence to suggest that any avian influenza can be transmitted to humans through the consumption of poultry, eggs or egg products.
What does it mean though for farmers and I guess for consumers in terms of prices of chicken and egg products?
So I understand that all of industry is working very hard to ensure that they can continue to produce sufficient supply for consumers so that they can continue to go into the shop and be able to purchase what the foods that they're used to purchasing. And as far as I'm aware, the production levels still haven't been significantly impacted. I understand that there are some restrictions that have been put in place, but that is to ensure that people can continue to consume these products. Well, the normal biosecurity measures are underway for instances just like this when it happens.
Naturally, people get concerned, and unfortunately, we see sometimes a reduced sale of egg products and chicken products when things like this happen. Your assurance today that the humans aren't at risk here. Is there anything else that people can do to lessen their risk, though?
No, there's nothing people need to do aside from the standard food safety measures, so making sure that they cook their products well and wash their hands and everything else that they should be doing when producing the food that they're about to eat. But it's not specifically for avian influenza. That's just very good food safety practices that everyone should continue to do.
A good reminder for us all. Doctor, thank you so much for your time this afternoon.